Greetings, and welcome to the Lone Gamer's 1,000 subscriber special question and answer video. Now, I've already said thank you to everyone, and will continue to thank everyone. But for now, of course, I don't want to waste any time, so let's get into the questions. There will be no particular order for the questions, and I'll try to answer every question as thoroughly as possible. So let's get to it. First question is from Max McMurry, who asks, can you tell us about your life outside YouTube? Okay, well, of course you know me as Mark the Lone Gamer. My actual name is Marco Antonio de Guzman de Maano, which probably is a mouthful for a lot of you out there who is not from Asia. You can just call me, of course, Mark. I am from the Philippines, which is in Southeast Asia for those who don't know. And, I have been a gamer for most of my life. I grew up here in the country. I think a fairly well-to-do or okay. Had a college education. Currently working in advertising, so we do commercials. Where I am a creative director in an advertising agency, and probably because of that, I am exposed to media, to commercials, to basically to entertainment, though I am not into or in the entertainment industry per se. So probably that's where I have a bit of my quote-unquote acting background. I got into YouTube a few years ago. It was actually just a side thing to my actual game blog online, which is thelonegamer.net. And it was only last year that I actually started posting videos there. Aside from, of course, Skyrim, which I honestly have been pretty much playing non-stop for the past 3 years, I also play mostly fighting games like Street Fighter, Tekken, Virtua Fighter, DOA, Soul Calibur, pretty much every fighting game you can find. I think I've probably played a bit. I also do some other RPGs, and depending on the game itself, probably every so often an adventure title, maybe a shooter, a lot of games. But I guess it's like how I describe myself in my game site. I am a hardcore casual gamer, which means I play games a lot. I love playing games, just not very well, and not enough to become an actual gamer expert like other people out there. I just play games, I just love to play them, and well, one day I just saw these very entertaining LPs on YouTube with from Skyrim, and somehow they just inspired me. So that's about it, I guess. Hope I answered your question well. Next question is from Stu the RPGer, who asks, how long did it take to reach 1,000 subscribers? Well, more or less a year for me. I imagine that really that could be a lot faster or take a lot longer depending on what your content is. For me, I started my YouTube channel a long time even before I started playing Skyrim. And for the longest time, I only had about 150 or just over 100 subscribers. And I really don't know how I got that many even then, because I really just posted a couple of videos on the channel. And it was supposed to be where I would be posting video reviews and features, which are basically that would be the video equivalent of the articles I write on my blog. But I never really did anything on it, so eh. But well, my content on the YouTube channel only started when I started doing the Skyrim LP. From there, it's been steadily rising, and thankfully, we reached 1,000 subscribers last week. So there, I attribute the relative slowness to being the simple fact that I only do a Skyrim roleplay, Skyrim LPs, and nothing else. If I did other games, like probably Call of Duty or even probably Clash of Clans or Heartfire or whatever, I probably reach 1,000 easy in a month or so. It really depends, but I don't like those games, so well, a year. Now, I hope I answered your question there. Next one is from David Karačić or Karasik. I hope I did not butcher your name. He asks, when will you continue the Tale of Jokir? Okay. Now, I'd like to publicly apologize for Tale of Jokir, both to Jokir himself and to the viewers. I started the Jokir playthrough because I thought that I could handle it, that I could do two LPs at the same time. And turns out that it's very hard. It's hard to put the time in, it's hard to just do the different thing with Jokir, because he is very different from Vrul, and you have to make it different for them to be, be distinct from one another. And the thing is, Jokir was never really supposed to be a long story like Vrul. Vril's my long-term indefinite project. Jokir was supposed to be just a short-term project, but it turned to be longer, and it was born from the idea that I wanted to try out the illusionist school in Skyrie. But eventually, it turned out that, Jokir also uses martial arts. And eventually, when I leveled him up and I was playing him, he became much too overpowered. And it after a while, the illusion... You reach a point in illusion once you get the master level spell, Lose Hope. There's this spell that you use which makes an enemy commit suicide. So they basically just drop dead when you hit them with it. The only limitation is that they must be lower level than you, and they're not something big like a dragon or a giant. And it was just too overpowered, because you could basically kill anyone. You could be the perfect assassin because you could use it, and NPCs could not detect it. Kill anyone. And it was much too overpowered. By the time that I reached that point, his barehanded attacks were doing like 200 points of damage with each claw, with each fist. And well, to make a long story short, too late, he wasn't an illusionist anymore. He was more like this superhero, and it kind of lost direction at that point, though I have to admit I had fun playing it. Unfortunately, for an LP about a Khajiit illusionist, it's kind of lost focus. But that all said, I would like to continue Jokier's LP, but in a different way. We will start from where we ended, which was not very long ago and not very far into the story, but we will be continuing Jokier's story in Percus Maximus. So yes, I think that's what I intend. We will continue Jokier as a character in Percus Maximus, in Perma, which I think fixes up the illusionist tree, which makes it less OP than before, and threshes out a lot of things like the phantoms and the spells. And I think I'll take care this time to really focus on him being an illusionist mage and maybe a bit of stealth. But we will be taking out the martial arts monk thing. How we'll do that, I'll leave that for the RP to tell. Okay. So when will this happen? Soon. Soonish. But we'll see. That's all I can promise for that. Okay, next. The next question is from Dennevar Warren, who asks three questions. The first one being, are you either French or French-Canadian? No and no. As I said, I am Filipino. I'm from the Philippines. That's it. Have you heard of the STEP or STEP project for Skyrim? No. Sorry. Would you consider trying it? Now, I assume that this is some sort of voice acting project, which is asking for people to volunteer for voicing characters for Skyrim remakes or other Bethesda games. And I honestly, I'd love to, but the thing is, I do not have the facility to do voice samples, to send proper quality voice samples online, because that's how I guess we'll be sending it. The thing is, I do not have a proper mic or a professional level mic here, which means that whatever sound sample I send may be of questionable quality, and it might differ from the standard that will be expected or needed for any such project. Now, I'll go into details of that in another video, I guess. But yeah, it'll probably be very hard to send voice samples of quality for these things. So unfortunately, unless that gets fixed up, I don't know if that will happen. Plus the time thing. And his third question is, can you please do a playthrough of Dragon Age Origins when you're done with Vrul and Jokier? Ah, okay. I have to say that I love the Dragon Age games. I loved Dragon Age Origins. And I played it to death years ago when it came out. I played it, three times. The third time, I think I really played it to get the best ending. But each and every time I played the human noble, never played the elf or the dwarf. But the thing is, I played it till I could not play no more, and I don't know if I'd be able to play it again. Especially that Inquisition is out, and I played that too, and I'm basically, for now I'm done with it. A couple of weeks ago, I was seriously thinking, a couple of months, I guess, I was seriously thinking of doing a Dragon Age Inquisition playthrough. but I gave up on that eventually because there is something about the Dragon Age games. They're not like Skyrim or the Bethesda games where they're really more open world, do what you will, create your own character, create your own story, role play, playground games. They're not. They're really these games where you basically play these set characters and you play through their stories. And in that, there's, I don't know, there's not that much room to play. You could give your chosen path or character sort of a voice, and you can do the background thing, but it just doesn't strike me as being that interesting. I mean, the story's great, but the story's done. You basically don't have anything surprising. Everything is known, you know where it's going to go, you know where it's going to end, and just going through it's just like going through the motions. So, very slim. Sorry, Dennevar, but still, I do have DAO on Steam, so we'll see. I mean, I won't say it's impossible, I'm just saying it's unlikely. Okay. Next question is from Dylan Thomas, one of our longtime watchers, who asks, what is your absolute favorite mod, whether you use it in your Let's Plays or outside of the vids? Okay, I'll give a proper answer, a funny answer, and a crazy answer. The proper answer would be, of course, it would have to be Skyri. But though now that has been replaced by Percus Maximus. Because as a single mod, this basically, these makeover mod, which basically redoes the entire game's perk system, it basically is what keeps me playing, and really it makes the game so much more in depth and detailed, and you can create so many different builds. It's incredible. Another answer would be, I'd say it has to be interesting NPCs, because the NPCs are so interesting. I mean, it is an absolutely incredible mod that I really thought before when I first saw it that it was just this thing that added in these guys and characters who just spoke a lot of stuff. But no, it actually turned out to be this mod that adds in all these little quests. Well, not that they're not just little quests, some are really large quests, and very well done. And it makes the world so much more, deeper, it makes it more detailed, it makes it more, quote-unquote, interesting. And the last but not least answer for this question would be it would be a tie between the CBBE and UNP demonized money. Next question is from Tarway Davis asks, what comes after the Skyrim RP? Another Skyrim RP. Well, seriously, I think as long as I love playing Skyrim, I will do RPs for it. But yeah, I do recognize that one cannot live on Skyrim alone. So I do plan on doing other games for the channel. One would be maybe Darkest Dungeon, which I actually bought last month on Steam. And it thoroughly kicked my ass, but it was very cool. I think that would be a very nice thing to try doing a role play for, even if it is basically a tabletop roguelike thing. But I think it's very open for that. I've seen other I mean, a lot of gamers are doing LPs on it these days, but I'd like to see the game when it's released as a final game. As it is right now, it's still on early access. You can't actually finish the game. So we'll probably keep that for the future. For the more short term, I have no idea. Maybe you people can suggest some games. As I said, I was thinking about an Inquisition playthrough, but I think people are doing it fine right now. I am currently watching a series by Jesse Cox, and I really like it. I mean, the guy plays a great Inquisition playthrough. He's very entertaining. And if you haven't seen it and you want to see DAI play gameplay, it's very entertaining. Very entertaining commentary with slight pseudo roleplay. He comes highly recommended from me. But other than that, we'll see. I have to like the game and really love it to make an a roleplay about it. So we'll see. But till then, well, I don't think my Skyrim LPs are going to end very soon. And I may be actually starting a new one based on Percus Maximus. And that's aside from the jokier LP. So we'll see. Okay, next one. Next question is from Vrul. Or Vrui? Vrul. Now, Vrul is one of our fellow Skyrim LPers. He is very distinct for his orc chieftain LPs, and I personally really love his stuff. I hope he continues doing his stuff. And he asks, what got you started in RPGs? Well, I started off liking RPGs when I was a kid, a long time ago. And well, in the Philippines back then, I read about Dungeons and Dragons in comics, or actually I don't remember where I read it. I guess in magazines. But to actually get my hands on Dungeons and Dragons books was, well, pretty much impossible for a kid with no budget, no nothing, no access, and there's no internet at that time. I eventually got my first Dungeons and Dragons set from a relative in the States who sent it back here to me. And it was the companion set, the first, the third set, which basically meant that I could not make heads or tails of the rules. But despite that, I still tried my best to make up my old rules as I went along. I even wrote in my sister and my brother to play with me, and even though I was just winging it the whole time. Though eventually I got more into D&D in school. I got a couple of classmates who played the RPGs. But not very much. I mean, I'm more of a reader. I love reading the books. I photocopied every rulebook I could find, mostly the stuff like Legends of Lore and the rulebooks and the stuff with the characters and the campaign settings. And it just, it's more about the lore for me and the stories. And I was more into the books like Choose Your Own Adventure, Fighting Fantasy, all the good stuff. And Vrul's next question is, would you grow a Viking beard? What makes you think that I don't have a Viking beard right now? No. Third question from Vrul is, who would win in a drunken bar fight, Jokir or Vrul, and why? Okay, Well, you could argue the joke here being basically a martial arts master, an ability to kill with his bare hands would win this in a heartbeat. But then again, if he actually drinks, he probably wouldn't be able to stand, so Vrul might win in a big upset by basically just stomping on his crotch while he's down on the floor. So who knows, it could go either way. It could be 50-50. But then again, if Vrul gets the upper hand, Sophia might hit him from behind, and well, it could go either way. Next question is from the Media Bunker, who asks quite a few questions. The first one being, have you ever participated in any theatrical productions, especially as an actor? Professionally, no. But I remember in college for a summer class, our group was given the assignment of staging an actual play, and we had to do everything. We rented a theater on the campus, we had makeup, costumes, a script, someone wrote a script, and pretty much everyone of us had a bit a part in the script. And I was given the part of an old man. And, we didn't have any practice beforehand. We just were given the scripts to memorize, and on the day itself, we were, the professors and some invited guests would watch the performance. And I was dressed up like an old guy. They threw some baby powder on my hair, and I slouched in the rocking chair and said my lines. Of course, as I said my lines, I did it in my old man voice. And up to that point, and well, throughout my life, I've always been the guy who likes doing voices. Especially in the Philippines, there's always this thing where it was a very common thing to do impressions of our former president, President Marcos, because he had this very distinct voice like an old guy. Basically I did that kind of voice, and people were actually impressed by it. I mean, I think everyone was staring at me, not believing that I was doing that. And so when curtain call came, I guess I got the biggest applause. But after that, never more. I didn't try any such acting. But since then, because I am in advertising, I've been handling radio and TV commercials. And of course, if you have to handle those things, you have to know about acting. So that's about the extent of my acting career. Media Bunker's second question is, have you ever played any tabletop RPGs, and if so, which ones? When I played RPGs before, they really were never these sessions where you actually go to someone's house or you meet up in a certain place and you set up the maps and stuff. We basically stole time in between lunch hour or recess, or sometimes after school, and they were just short play times, and we just wing it. We just have the dice and some notebooks, and the module, I guess, a Xerox module. But aside from that, I guess I played the original Dungeons and Dragons. I played a bit of Gangbusters and Star Frontier. I think I'm really old. and some other things. But aside from that, not really that much. His third question is, what was your method for creating the characters you're playing in Skyrim? So this is about the backstory, the personality, the accent, goals, and stuff. I think this ties in with some other questions from some other subscribers, but I guess I'll answer it right here. Really, I got the idea for playing Vrul from he was basically inspired by someone else. You have committed crime also against... in the Skyrim LPing circle. I got it from the idea that that there were very few people who actually were playing high elves in Skyrim and doing let's plays for them. So yes, this came from Sorcerer Dave's LP, from his actually, it's not from his Skyrim LP, it's from his Oblivion LP, where he, during his first video for his character Idris in A Wizard Is Never Late LP. And because of that, I thought, yeah, maybe if there are so few people playing High Elves, why not? So I thought of doing that. And the backstory... You know, the backstory I just made up on the fly while I was actually doing the video. When I did the... If you watch the prologue video, the prelude video for A Coming of Mage story, that was basically just me winging it throughout the entire video. I was making it up as I went along. Though, I admit I did have a rough idea of where he came from, because I didn't want him to be from the Somerset Isles, because I didn't know anything about the Somerset Isles, and I wanted him to be more cosmopolitan, more human, and more approachable, rather than this high and mighty high elf from the high elf capital, from the Aldmeri Dominion, who would probably be very not nice. As for his personality, well, yeah, it made it up just... It came along with the voice, and the voice because... I think the voice happened because it was easy for me to do. Doing Vrul's voice is basically just me... I think upping the octave, I think, if that's the correct term. Upping the octave with my voice. So you just raise it a bit, and you got Vrul. And the funny thing is, when I do the voice of Vrul, is that when I do his voice and you turn on his character, it's so easy to talk as him. It's almost like the character is born from this idea of him, and it just creates him on the fly. As I said, I'm Filipino, and while we are supposedly the third largest English-speaking nation in Asia, or probably the world, English is not my first language, and certainly not my conversational language. It takes an effort for me to talk as straight as this without sounding weird. But if I speak as Vrul, if you hear me in some of the later episodes, I'm just talking there very, very quickly, very straight, and it's... That is all with no scripts, nothing. That's all on the fly. So, there is that weird thing that the character is speaking through the voice. As for the goals, yeah, the goals of the character happen just... It's just a very direct goal of him becoming powerful. I think other characters, of course, will... should have deeper goals. It was my Vrul's playthrough is my first ever LP, so he's pretty much very simple. As for Jokir, yeah, he he was born from the idea that I wanted this Khajiit character. I've been seeing these other LPs and videos of Khajiit on YouTube, and they were doing really nice voices, especially the NPCs in interesting NPCs. So I wanted to try it out myself, and I don't know. I think I did decently. The thing is with Joke here, the hard thing is that this voice is very hard to do. It's a lot more, there's a lot more effort to it than Vrul. And you really have to, well, I really have to work on keeping him distinct from Vrul in everything. Particularly how he's motivated. And I think as well that at first he was supposed to be a bit darker than he turned out to be. But as of now, I'm still not used to the idea of playing an evil character. Because Jokir eventually turns out to be more of a neutral than evil. And I'm saving an actual really more dubious character for the future. But I'm still not sold on playing evil, because I don't know, I don't really see evil, totally evil characters as being very likable or interesting to watch unless you're playing it for laughs. Like, I think I've seen that in Gopher's Orc Warlock playthrough. But yeah. Anyway, yeah, the method for creating characters, I really can't say about the method. It's really more just thinking up what comes along naturally. I guess having a clear idea of what you want them to be and just doing it. And next question. Do you play any other video or PC games besides Skyrim regularly? If so, which ones? Lately, I've been playing a lot of... Dragon Age Inquisition. That's the only other game I've been playing along for a long period of time aside from Skyrim. So I did play... some time ago, I played Tekken Tag 2. I played Virtua Fighter 5 Final Showdown. I played Sunset Overdrive. I do own the Xbox One. I play a lot of games. Not all of them a long time. Some of them I just play a bit. Some of them I just buy from the store and never open. Next question from Ninja Bunker. Are there any other LPs you have in mind down the road which you would really like to post on YouTube, or any types of videos you'd like to post for that matter? As I said before, we will continue Skyrim LPs because that is basically what my channel is all about. But yeah, I am thinking of other video games to do, other things to do. I don't know. I was thinking of more videos like impression videos or special features, but well, it really depends on the game. If I really like the game, maybe I'll talk about it. But I was thinking of doing retro videos for fighting games, but that might be... I'm not really good at fighting games, but I love them so much. Just that I'm not really good at them compared to other players, I guess. I'm not really an online player. I'd love for suggestions, but it might be limited by my being that I can only do videos or content for stuff that I like myself. So we'll see. Again, I will consider stuff that happens down the line, but it's probably... be safe to say that I will do more RPGs More stuff that you could actually role play, which you probably can't do with fighting games. But we'll see. And the last question from Media Bunker is, how are you doing and are you happy? Is life good and feeling fine? This is a bit tricky because I think it might be very jinxy to say that you're happy. I don't want to say that I'm happy because things might go wrong suddenly. But suffice to say that I am doing something that I love doing for people who are awesome, and I'm, as of right now, I'm doing it for free. I'm not doing this for monetary goals. I'm not, my channel isn't monetized. I don't think it will be monetized anytime soon, but I love doing it, having fun doing it, and I think that is just one of the reasons that I can truly say that I am very okay. Thank you for that, Media Bunker. Really, thank you. And moving on. Well, Dylan Rine also asks, will you RP another game in the future? You know, as I've said, maybe Darkest Dungeon. Maybe if Dragon Age Inquisition gets an expansion, maybe we'll do that. I haven't ruled out doing an Inquisition playthrough, but yeah, maybe I'll need something to get me back into the game, like an expansion set or something. Well, other than that, it depends. I do want to play Skywind or the remakes, the more Oblivion remakes that people are doing, and beyond Skyrim stuff. So I'm keeping my eyes on that. And I remembered that I might do Oblivion, or consider doing Oblivion, or, well, yeah, an Oblivion Let's Play or roleplay eventually. The thing is, I am limited by the fact that I am very sure that you can't use the controller with Oblivion, which would really make playing it a bit hard for me. But we'll see. I haven't ruled it out. But yeah, seeing game LPs from other LPers on YouTube with Oblivion is little by little convincing me that maybe Oblivion Let's Play. Okay. Next question is from Josh Johnson, who is one of our really long time subscribers, and he asks, how did Vrul's voice come about? This is a bit similar to another question before, but this is more specific. Yeah, Vrul's voice was born from the idea of the character. He was supposed to be this kinda sorta high and mighty elf. So he's a bit of he's a bit snooty, a bit stuffy, and a bit of a snob. So you have that very nasal tone from him. And he was, of course, influenced by various characters. I think one of the big influences is of course, from Skyrim itself, from Neloth, from the character of Neloth. I think that was one of the inspirations. But I can honestly say that probably one of the big inspirations for him, at least for me, actually, doing his voice the way he does, the way I do, is because of a certain person. That will come more in detail later. But yeah, a little more history about him. I did say that the prelude that Vrul came from Cyrodiil. He was forced to leave Cyrodiil, where he was the son, or he was in a wealthy merchant family. But he was forced away from Cyrodiil to relocate to Skyrim. Now, the real story about this is that basically his family all died. They all died in a fire. He was away handling their affairs, their business affairs at the warehouse, and their house burned down with his parents in it. And when he came back, as I think he had a line in his monologue where he says there is nothing left in Cyrodiil for him but ashes. So that's basically what it was about. And though it was never proven, he did suspect that the Thalmor had something to do with the accident, because his family were among those exiles from Somerset who escaped the purges of the Thalmor, or whatever those things were, and it's not a stretch for them to have been attacked by Thalmor agents or elements of the Thalmor even decades after their leaving the Somerset Isles. So that's why he was a bit more hateful of the Thalmor coming into the story. And you heard, of course, from him about the loyal attendant. He came to Skyrim with one other person, aside from the caravan that he had, everything that he had left. And that person was his bodyguard, his longtime attendant, and she was a dark elf. Her name was Laerl, if you would remember from the prelude. And she was a spell sword, a very powerful spell sword. But of course, she supposedly died from the bandit raid near Darkwater Crossing, or wherever they were there. And she supposedly sacrificed her life for Vrul. They never found her body, so we'll see. Josh Johnson's third question is Lydia his love interest? You tell me. I think Vrul is, thankfully, Vrul is a bit of more of a, he grew up in Cyrodiil, so he's been among the other races, so he built up this attraction for other peoples of Tamriel. And yes, he does certainly find Lydia very attractive. And of course, in my game, she is very attractive. I mean, every woman probably is attractive in my Skyrim. But it's, for now, for after you say, it seems to be an unrequited love. Lydia seems to be very professional, very standoffish. But really, Vrul is, I think it's just a crush thing. He's not really serious. But that doesn't mean that he's not looking for love. He does want to find that special someone. Who this will be? Will it be Lydia? Well, let's see where the story goes. Okay, thank you for that, Josh. The next question is from the Game Master 332. who asks, what are your top favorite LPs? All right, now this is a very good question. Now the thing is that these LPs are the ones that actually got me doing my Skyrim roleplays in the first place. Now, I mean, I've watched so many Skyrim LPs, and I think I should keep them to Skyrim LPs. But I think I'll narrow it down to five, or the most important ones. I think one would certainly be the LP of Pem Medician, or Pem the Loathsome Casual, who has the Anai Glossed LP, and I just love that LP because, for one, it introduced so many ideas to me of how to do an LP, where you actually do a character who is not the Dragonborn, who introduces a lot of elements in the story, like your own NPCs that are not in the vanilla game. I mean, well, yeah, we do modded playthroughs anyway. But yeah, he did so many things which are so wonderfully creative and very interesting for me to watch, and I just love watching his stuff, and how in depth he goes into the story, the character, and there are even cutscenes and stuff. And in that same vein, another favorite LP of mine, of course, is Sorcerer Dave's I, Claudius LP, which I feel is just really amazing the way he just tells the story. I mean, if you haven't listened to Sorcerer Dave, you just have to give it a try if you're interested in Skyrim LPs. But I think who hasn't seen him if you're into Skyrim LPs? You probably have. Aside from the fact that he just has this amazing voice, he just puts in so much detail and thought into his stories, and well, yeah, he's just very entertaining, very funny, and he's very epic when he tells his stories. And in that same vein, my absolute really favorite of his is his Oblivion playthrough. I just love his Oblivion playthrough, even if I really don't play Oblivion myself. I love the story of Idris and the A Wizard Is Never Late LP. It's just fabulous. I could just watch it for hours. And that's three. The next one, of course, would be Gopher's Richard playthrough. It's just one of the longest running LPs there is. And one could probably argue that Gopher is a bit too mainstream, but I don't think so. I mean, yes, his way of doing his LPs is half mod talk and half slightly kind of role playing. But if you watch the first few episodes, he's very similar to the way Sorcerer Dave does. He puts a lot of thought into the character. And while he doesn't do the voice like others do, like I do, or you don't have to tell a story, he still gets it across. And I mean, he does the really, his LPs are very funny, he's very consistent with his story, and you can just tell that he loves Skyrim so much. And it shows in the way he plays, the way he does his plays, and the way he's built up this whole saga of this librarian from Cyrodiil, and his becoming a warrior and a werewolf, and it's pretty goddamn awesome. But of course, the one that I have to say is the one, my number one favorite LP is, of course, from Damo 2968. Is Skyrim playthrough where he plays the wizard Elwit. And I have to say, he plays it on the Xbox 360, I think. So he doesn't have mods. But that doesn't matter. The great thing about Damo is his voice. And the thing is that his voice, he really sounds like a wizard. And that in that way, I have to say that he is probably the single person who influenced the way I do my LPs. Because he just has this amazing voice, which just makes you think that he's a bearded guy with a staff, but he's no Gandalf. He's like this sprightly younger wizard type character, but he doesn't look like that. I mean, if you see who he is, but that's his actual voice, which is funny. And I have to really make it an effort to do my own voice for Vrul. But he is like he was born with that voice. But it's pretty awesome. And aside from having the voice, his storytelling is really, really very witty. It's funny. And I guess it really is part of the voice. Anything he does, he says, is just so poetic and just so epic. And I think after watching all, I think 300 or 400 episodes of that, I just had to say that I just wanted to follow this guy's example and try to do my best. And I think maybe we did that with Vrul. I haven't done half as many episodes as he has, but we've only just begun. Okay, the next question is from Pem, the Loathsome Casual, who graces us with his questions. And one of his first questions is, describe one of the most formative experiences of your life. What is one of the major experiences you've had that has the most effect on you and who you are today? So I think one was perhaps during my first job. My first job in an advertising agency, and I was an intern. And for a while I was doing well until a certain point where I was given this very big project. And basically, the stress got to me. So at the end, I kind of came up short on the ideas. My ideas didn't measure up to the standards of the supervisor, who before was very, very supportive of me and seemed to be very much behind me. But because of this incident, she basically sat me down and fired me and just said that I wasn't right for the industry, that I lacked the passion and the ability to work in a team for some reason. And basically she judged that I wasn't up to par. And so at that point I felt really crushed. But afterwards I decided I didn't give a fuck's sake of what she said. And I just turned around, went to another agency, worked there, and pretty much have found that I am a damn good advertising person, no matter what that person judged me. And so, yeah, that I guess that taught me that no matter who these people are who may judge you, it's only true if you believe them or accept their judgment. And in the end, it's up to you whether you are what you are or what you can be. I guess that's one of the most formative experiences of my life. Pem's next question is, what was your inspiration for the character of Vrul? Well, to be honest, yeah, Vrul was, of course, born from the need for me to fill in the slot for a high elf character, which I, of course, decided on because I heard from Sorcerer Dave's Let's Play that he thought that there weren't any Altmer LPs around for Oblivion or Skyrim or whatever. So I decided there that, yeah, I do the High Elf myself. And when I was trying to do a High Elf, I was thinking what the character would be. Now, I wanted it to be different from Dave's character, Idris, who was this elf from the Somerset Isles. Because I myself, being not very learned in the lore of the Elder Scrolls, relatively, I decided to put Vrul, or his full name being Vrilian Litharn, from Cyrodiil. So he was more of an elf who grew up or was raised in an environment with other races. So he's more open-minded. He's not of the usual Altmer purist mindset. And from there I created his character. I filled in the little gaps, like he was born rich, probably grew up with a silver spoon, he was a bit of a rich snob, but deep inside he had a good heart, most probably because he was raised he grew up alongside a very good person who was his lifelong attendant, Laerl, who he often talked about in the first episode in the prelude, who basically gave him more lessons in life that kept him from becoming too much of a rich, uncaring, highborn bastard. but he still has that bit of tendency to be a bit of a pompous ass. Yes, he can be a bit sarcastic and grouchy and thinks a bit too highly of himself. But yeah, I think he does have his redeeming qualities. And of course, going about how to do his voice, I followed the manner of the existing NPCs in Skyrim, of the High Elves, like the Altmer characters like Ankano and Elenwen. I tried to do my own version of their voices, but it eventually turned out to be something more like a cross between Inspector Gadget and maybe Maxwell Smart from Get Smart. But really, the most important aspects of his voice were, for me, was that I could do it easily and consistently, and that it was something that I could really roll with, and I think I succeeded in doing it. The inspiration for that, of course, are more or less other wizards in fiction, though I could have gone with a more older character like a la Gandalf or Deckard Cain, but I did for a while think about doing an older wizard, but I think it wouldn't be as much fun. So Vrul is more like the younger magic user, the one who's still a lot less wisdom, more of intelligence, or trying to make his mark in the world as yet. Pem's next question was that whom were you thinking of as a model when you were creating the character? Well, yeah, I mean, it still ties into there. What a model. Didn't really have a particular model in mind for him. He's a character born of the archetype that he is a wizard or a wizard to be, a wizardling, a mageling, and he's a wannabe. He starts out as a wannabe, and but he has potential, and he is a person shaped by his background and the circumstances that forced him into his current situation. And I think that a lot of that and his background story, I think, makes him very easy to identify with and to sympathize with early on. Yeah, because I think that's where you begin to rope in viewers and watchers, if you get them early on with the character's story. And I think this is very true for many LPs out there. I've seen it with, of course, with Sorcerer Dave, with Gopher, with stuff from Ain Online and Niesa Gaming, and every one of the great LPs of Skyrim LPs that I watch on YouTube. You have to be able to tell the character story and mold the character from there. Pem's next question is, has the character turned out differently than you expected setting out? Very much so. I never expected Vrul to be as likable as he is. I mean, I knew coming out that, like many other characters in this type of LP or roleplay, he was supposed to be unlikable at the start, and you would like him eventually. But I think that he becomes likable even very early on. Now, I didn't really expect to do this right away. I mean, he was supposed to be a bit more of an irritating, annoying character. I mean, he'd take credit more for things that his hirelings or his comrades do. He'd be more of cowardly and stuff, but it didn't turn out that way. I mean, the way I eventually played it was that he had to step up as much as he could, and he turned out to be more caring and more sympathetic than I intended at first. But it still didn't take away from his personality. He still was very sarcastic, is very quirky, very grouchy, and because of that, he I think became a very interesting character and very entertaining to listen to and to speak for. Pem next asks about your talents. I've noticed in a comment here or there that you mentioned that you haven't had any formal acting experience. Yes, that's true. What convinced you to commit to the first-person narration and voice acting you use in the Vrul LP? Ah, yes. Well, to tell you the truth, I really did not have a full idea of what I was getting myself into when I started out. When I first did the prelude video for Vrul and I told his story, at that point, I really didn't realize that I was going to do the LP like I did starting from there, because ultimately I would not be able to do it the way other LPers do. I could not talk about mods because I don't know the first thing about mods. I can't speak about them by myself. I'm not a funny, witty character by myself, so I'm not as bubbly as a commentator as many other LPers out there. So what I could only do was speak as the character himself and act it out as things happen on screen in real time. And thankfully, apparently, it worked out. Complete with reactions to whatever's happening to Vrul on screen and everything that entails that. I mean, and I guess it works. And looking at it, looking at the episodes, it is really strange for me to look back at the old episodes. Up to now, we've had a bit more than 60. And it really boggles the mind somehow. Did I say that? Or how was I able to get all these thoughts and words into these episodes? Because really, in every episode, I don't work with a script. Everything is unscripted. Now, even if the footage itself, the gameplay, has been pre-recorded, I don't play and record in real time because I don't have the facility for it. But even though it's pre-recorded, I don't know what's really going to happen. I don't memorize the thing that happens in the hours and hours of gameplay footage that I've captured. So when it happens, it's basically happening as I am saying it. And pretty much almost every time, I always get the episodes done in one take. So everything is about as spontaneous as you can get. And it surprises me that once I take on the voice, it basically gives me access to this person, this different character who speaks about as fluently and as straight as a character can speak in his voice. It's not me who's talking, it's really this person, Vrul, who has the dialogue and the vocabulary, the mannerisms that he speaks is totally him. And the way he reacts to the stuff happening on screen and his thoughts on it and his interests, that basically fills out every episode. And somehow it works. And yes, it only took me about up to the second or third episode where I realized that really I had something here and I was going to do this moving forward. I think the first couple of episodes 3 and 4 in particular, I'm really happy with how I ended those episodes. It almost looks like it was really planned and scripted, but it really wasn't. It just happened like that and it just worked. And I think from there I knew that I could do this, I can keep on doing this consistently. And Pem's next question is, what's something interesting you learned by doing the LP? I learned that I could do roleplay, and it's really a very creative exercise. It's very stimulating intellectually for me to be able to do this. And it's really very fulfilling for me to be able to find an audience on YouTube who appreciates this mode of storytelling, which I am beginning to think about dubbing as story gaming. I think it's probably one of the medium, the ways of storytelling in this day and age. I'm probably blowing it out of proportion, but I think it's one of those things that comes along with YouTube and Let's Plays and the gaming phenomenon, the way it's... I know for a fact that in my own experience, watching Let's Plays on YouTube has basically replaced television for me. And so that's why it's very interesting that we ourselves are gamers, are making our own entertainment, and it's almost like a communal thing amongst gamers. We're appreciating something that is within our experiences, our circle. That's really very interesting. And last but not least, Pem's last question is, what is your favorite curse word and why? And he asks this just for kicks. Now, I think it's pretty obvious. My favorite curse word is damn it. Or as Vrul would say, damn it. Damn it. probably because this came probably from my days in the CAT, military training in college and high school, where the officers would always say, damn it, cadet, damn it, damn it. And you could basically just put this in at the end of any sentence, and he can put it in any situation that Vrul gets himself into, and he can just throw it out, and it's pretty funny. It's a curse that really isn't as heavy as I think as the F word, and I can basically just keep on saying it, and it doesn't sound as harsh. It's more funny, I think, at this point. And well, that's it from Pem's questions, and we have one last question from Roxanne Saxa, who asks, if there is an orc named Tim eating a sweet roll and another orc named Tom eating an apple dumpling, who wins in a fight between the cabbage and a tomato? I think the answer to that is swallow a soul gem. And I think that's it for the question and answer video. And really, I'd like to once again thank everyone who sent in questions. And I'd like to thank everyone who subscribed. It's really amazing that we've reached and, well, surpassed 1,000 subscribers. When you have 1,000 subscribers, I think you can fill up 4 jumbo jets if all of you came to a convention with me. So that's something. Now, I don't have as many subscribers as the big boys out there, but who knows, someday, maybe 100 years from now, we'll have 100,000. Anyway, we'll continue the Skyrim LPs very soon, and I will be posting more videos about my future plans. Everyone is, of course, welcome to suggest and to send me their feedback, and see what happens. Anything is possible, I think. But yeah, anything is possible if I have the heart for it. But for now, though, thank you everyone again for watching and subscribing to the Lone Gamers YouTube channel, and we will see you again soon.